Okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Today we will cover a new chapter that is fundamental of metal forming. Okay, in this chapter we will have an overview of metal forming, that what is metal forming, behavior of material in metal forming, as well as temperature in metal forming, strain rate, sensitivity, friction, and application in metal forming. Now, what is metal forming, or what do you mean by metal forming? So, metal forming includes a large group of manufacturing processes in which plastic deformation is used to change the shape of metal workpiece. So you have plastic deformation. It means that you have permanent deformation in the metal, and you are going to shape that metal piece due to the plastic deformation. The tool that are used in metal forming is known as dies, which apply stresses or forces that exceed yield strength of material. And when it exceeds the yield strength of the material, definitely it will go under the plastic deformation, and due to the pressure or forces of dies, the metal change the shapes according to the die. The metal takes a shape determined by the geometry of die. Now this shape is totally dependent on the shape of the die. So what will be the shape will definitely transform to the metal due to the forces that exceeds the yield strength of metal, and definitely metal will get the shape of the die. Stresses to plastically deform the metal are usually compressive. So these stresses that are applied on the metal are usually compressive forces, and due to these compressive forces, when these compressive forces exceeds the yield strength, so plastic deformation of metal occur and the shape of the metal is changed. Our shape or geometry of the metal is changed. Some example of metal formings are rolling, forging, and extrusion. However, some forging processes stretches the metal. In that case, you have tensile stresses. Other bend, that is the combination of tensile and compressive stresses, and still other applied shear stresses. So you will experience all these types in next coming slides. So material property required in metal forming. So what are the material property that are required in metal formings? Are that they must be have low yield strength and high ductility. By low yield strength means that it can be easily deformed, and that have high ductility of the material. So these desirable material properties are low yield strength and high ductility. So these properties are affected by the temperatures. Since ductility increases and yield strength decreases when temperature is raised, when you are going to increase the temperature, definitely the yield strength will decrease and ductility of the metal will increase. So temperature affect both these properties. Effect of temperature give rise to distinction between cold, warm, and hot working. So different due to the temperature effect, we also classified them as cold, warm, and hot working. That is discussed in next slides. Other factors are strain rate and friction. So these are the certain properties that are required in metal forming. Now, metal forming processes are majorly classified into two main categories. The first one is bulk deformation processes, and the second is metal working processes. So what is sheet metal working processes? What are the difference between basic these two types? That in bulk deformation processes we have massive shape change, and the deformation is significant, while in sheet metal working processes the you can say that the surface area to volume ratio is high. What do you mean by it? Now, see, in bulk deformation processes are characterized by significant deformation and massive shape changes. So you have massive shape change. जो shape change होती है वो काफी massive होती है, दिखती है काफी बड़े मिकदार में इसकी shape changes होती हैं. So bulk refer to the work part with relatively low surface area to volume ratio. Up now you can see low surface area to volume ratio. So surface area over volume ratio कब low होगा, जब volume ज़्यादा होगा bulk में होगा और उसका सरफेस एरिया कम होगा. सो बल्क रेफर टू द वर्क पार्ट विथ रिलेटिवली लो सरफेस एरिया टू वॉल्यूम रेशियो. नाउ अगर आपको ये चीज़ याद रहती है, सो शीट मेटल वर्किंग इज अपोजिट टू दैट. किस तरह वो भी आगे आ रहा है, लेकिन मैं आपको बताता हूँ कि शीट मेटल वर्किंग में आपके पास शीट्स होती हैं दैट हैव हायर सरफेस एरिया एज कम्पेयर टू वॉल्यूम, ठीक है ना. तो उसमें हाई सरफेस एरिया टू वॉल्यूम रेशियो होता है और इसमें लो सरफेस एरिया टू वॉल्यूम. लो सरफेस एरिया टू वॉल्यूम अगेन इज दैट यू हैव हाई सरफेस एरिया डिवाइड बाय सॉरी सरफेस एरिया डिवाइड बाय हाई वॉल्यूम, ठीक है ना. सो दैट इज बल्क. व्हाइल इन शीट मेटल वर्किंग यू हैव हाई सरफेस एरिया, क्योंकि शीट्स अगर आप देखें तो शीट्स का सरफेस एरिया काफी ज्यादा होता है. सो वॉल्यूम अगर उसका कम हो तो भी तो उस शीट मेटल वर्किंग में आपके पास जो है वो हाई सरफेस एरिया टू वॉल्यूम रेशियो होता है. नाउ स्टार्टिंग वर्क शेप इंक्लूड सिलेंड्रिकल बिलेट्स एंड रेक्टेंगुलर बार्स. सो बल्क डिफॉर्मेशन प्रोसेस में जो स्टार्टिंग जिसकी हम शेप चेंज करते हैं दैट इंक्लूड्स सिलेंड्रिकल बिलेट्स एंड रेक्टेंगुलर बार दैट आर produced by casting process, and further you perform deformation processes, bulk deformation processes in order to alter the shape of these cylindrical billets and rectangular bar into required shapes. So these are bulk deformation processes. The bulk deformation processes are categorized into rolling, forging, extrusion, and drawing. All will be discussed in next slides or in next lectures. But you can see that in rolling, you can see the material is placed inside the rollers, and due to the rolling effect, the thickness of the material is reduced. So in forging, you can see that this is a bulk mass, and due to the dies and the force of the dies, it gets deformed and get the shape of the die. Similarly, in extrusion, you have the material in the form of cylindrical billets, and you are going to push through ramp. And there is opening in the die, so material plastically deforms and will come out of this orifice and will get the shape of this die. Also in drawing, you can see the same material. There are dies. You are going to draw this material, so it get the shape of this orifice. So all these processes are bulk deformation processes in which the surface area to volume ratio is low. And see over there that low surface area to volume ratio. So such type of deformations are known as bulk deformation process, and this is a type of metal forming operations. Now sheet metal working. In sheet metal working, definitely that is working related with the metal sheets. So sheet metal working processes are forming and related operation perform on metal sheets, strips and coils. So they have high surface area to volume ratio of starting material. I have already told you that you know that sheets have higher volume surface area, so it will and lower volume. For lower volume, it may have higher surface. So surface area to volume ratio of sheet metal working is high, which distinguish this from bulk deformation. Often they are called press working because presses perform these operations. There are presses which are used to deform the shape of these sheets, and the parts that are produced are called stamping. Here the tool that are uses are known as punches and dies. So these are basically sheet metal processes. So in this case, you can see that is bending. There is a die, punch and die, and punch exert force, and due to this force, the sheet metal plastically deform and get the shape of this die and punch. There is a deep drying, so you have this working material sheet plates that is placed over a die and punch is going to exert force and it get the shape of that die. So that is known as deep drying. Similarly, here you can see that for cutting the sheet metals, you are going to apply shear forces through using punch. This is a die, this is a punch. You are going to apply shear force and you get cuts the sheet metal over here. So these are the some example of sheet metal working. Now, metal behavior in the material behavior in metal forming. So what are the behavior that are experienced by metal in by material in metal forming? So typically we apply stress and strain is produced in the body when stress exceed the yield strength of the material. So definitely a plastic deformation occurs. So typical stress strain curve for the most material is divided into an elastic region as well as in plastic region. There you know this thing very well. Plastic region of the stress strain curve is primary interest because material is plastically or permanently deformed. So we have concern with plastic region of stress strain curve because the material undergoes a permanent change, and due to this permanent shape, it get the material behave plastically, and due to excessive loads, the material will get changed shape. In plastic region, metal behavior is expressed by flow curve, and this flow curve is generally that stress is equal to K epsilon raised to power n, where K is strength coefficient, n is strain hardening component, epsilon is strain, and sigma is strength. So stress and strain in the flow curve are true stress and true strain. So in this flow curve, this stress and strain are actually a true stress. You know that difference between engineering stress and true stress. So these stress are true stresses and true strain. So flow curve is a valid relationship for cold working. So this relation is valid for cold working. We will see what is cold working and what is hot working in few, next few slides. But this flow curve is a valid relationship for a cold working processes. For most metal at room temperature, strength increases when deformed due to strain hardening. So at room temperature, due to strain hardening, the strength of the material is increases. So in what is flow stress? It is an instantaneous value of stress required to continue deforming the material to keep metal flowing. So flow stress is basically the stress that's help us in that helps the material to keep on flowing for the permanent deformation. So this stress instant of sigma, you are going to now represent it by yf because it's the flow stress, and that is equal to k epsilon raised to power, and where yf the flow stress, that is the yield strength as the function of strain. So why it is known as yield strength as the function of strain? Because when this is the stress that will help us in material to flow. So when it will flow, where? Because when it will flow will help in flowing the material when it exceeds the yield strength of the material. So definitely yf will be equal or larger than the yield strength that will allow the material to plastically deform. That is why that is yield strength as a function of strain. So the flow stress of the material is the strength property that determine forces and power required to accomplish a particular forming operation. So ये वही बात है कि flow stress material के strength property है जो कि आपको forces और power की वजह से जो है जो stress है वो आपको plastic deformation देती है, ठीक है ना, ताकि आप एक particular shaping operation जो है वो accomplish कर सकें. Now, what is average flow stress? So in some process like extrusion, average flow stress, that definition is the average value of stress over the stress strain curve from beginning of the strain to the final maximum value that occur during formation is more useful than instantaneous flow stress. So being at any instant of at any instant point you are going to get flow stress. So you, the benefit is that you take the average value of that flow. So that is determined by YF dash is equal to K epsilon N over 1 plus N. Now this equation can be obtained if we integrate this YF, this or this equation over the region from strain 0 to the maximum value. So if you integrate that equation, you will get this average flow stress that is equal to K epsilon over N, K epsilon power N over 1 plus N, where YF is the average flow stress and epsilon is the maximum strain during the deformation process. Now you can see that this is stress strain, true stress or shear rate, stress strain curve, you can see that. So this is the Y, that is yield strength, and beyond this yield strength, there's a permanent deformation, so that why this force is known as flow stress. And due to this flow, the strain is produced, that strain is actually a permanent deformation of the body. So if you are going to identify the flow stress at any instantaneous point, so better is to get the average value of this flow stress. Now this is simply YF is equal to K epsilon rest power N, and this YF determine you the average value of flow stress, so over the maximum strain. So again, you can get this average flow stress equation by integrating this YF over the strain from starting from zero to the maximum value. So you will get this flow stress, average flow strain stress equation. So YF, the flow stress, epsilon is the maximum strain for forming operation, K is strength coefficient, and YF is the average flow stress. So this there is a small problem. You have given K, you have given N for a certain metal during a forming operation. The final true strain that the metal experience, epsilon, is 0.73. So you have been asked here that to determine the flow stress at this strain and the average flow stress the metal experienced during the operation. So you have three value, K, N, and epsilon. So you have to define YF and YF dash. So K, epsilon, N is given. First put this value, you will get YF. And then again, using for getting the average flow stress, you will have to put the K, epsilon, N, and N value for in this equation. So you will get the flow, average flow stress. So this is a simple problem, finally solved. Now temperature in metal forming. For any metal, K and N in the flow curve depend on temperature. Now the value of clay, stress coefficient, and strain hardening, that depend on temperature. Both strength and strain hardening are reduced at higher temperature. So you know that when temperature is high, so strength will definitely reduce and strain will also reduce, but ductility increases. So in addition, ductility is increased at higher temperature. Any deformation operation can be accomplished with lower forces and power at elevated temperature. So if you have lower forces, so you can achieve the forming operation at एलिवेटेड टेम्परेचर. मतलब यह है कि अगर आपके पास डिफॉर्मेशन, अगर कोई ऑपरेशन है और उसमें आपके पास लोअर फोर्सेस हैं, सो दैट ड्यू टू दिस लोअर फोर्सेस डिफॉर्मेशन प्रोसेस कैन बी अचीव बट एट एलिवेटेड टेम्परेचर, हाई टेम्परेचर. सो थ्री टेम्परेचर रेंजेस इन मेटल फॉर्मिंग. द फर्स्ट वन इज कोल्ड वर्किंग, द सेकेंड वन इज वार्म वर्किंग, एंड थर्ड वन इज हॉट वर्किंग. सो वी विल एक्सप्लेन वन बाय वन. नाउ कोल्ड वर्किंग. In cold working, the operations are performed at a temperature or slightly at a room temperature or slightly above. So many cold forming processes are important mass production operations. So these cold working operations are performed at a room temperature or slightly above temperature. So minimum or no machining usually required. So in this type of working process, no machining is required, and we get the shapes that are near net or net shape, because in net shapes you have required no machining, while in near net shape you will require some minimum machining. So that's why they are saying that minimum or no machining is usually required, and this operation produce near net or net shape objects in the process are net shape or near net shape processes. So due to strain hardening, the strength of material increases and ductility decreases during cold work process. As we have previously discussed that due to strength of due to strain hardening at cold working, so strength of the material will decrease while ductility decreases during cold working process. While if you have higher temperature, that will not cold working operation. So in that case, the strain hardening and strength will decrease and ductility will increase. Now, what are the advantages of cold working and what are its disadvantages? So advantages are better accuracy and closer tolerance because you are going to get the shape due to dies, better surface finish. You also know that strain hardening increases, so strength will also increase. Grain flow during deformation can cause desirable directional property in the product. So due to deformation, so grain flows during deformation will move in a desirable direction properties in the product. So this is also an advantage. No heating of work is required, so lower fuel cost and higher production rates. So that is the advantage. Disadvantage is that ductility is decreased due to cold working operation. The second one is due to normal temperature or temperature somewhat above the room temperature, higher forces are and powers are required. So surface of starting workpiece must be free of scale and dirt. That must be, because if the surface will contain dirt and some scales, that definitely it will damage the surface. Ductility and straight hardening limit the amount of forming that can be done. In some operation, metal must be annealed to allow the further deformation, because in annealing the material become slightly soft. So that's why the metal must be annealed to allow the further deformation. In other cases, metal is simply not ductile enough to be cold work. So these are the disadvantages. Now, what is warm working? So warm working is defined as that type of metal forming operation that is performed at temperature above room temperature but below recrystallization temperature. Now, what is recrystallization temperature? Recrystallization temperature is actually the temperature of metal that its grains are going to, or its you can say the crystals or atoms are going to arrange themselves in a definite order. So we can also have a proper definition that recrystallization temperature is the temperature at which material, usually metal, is reformed. Now, what is mean by metal reform? So metal reformation means that rearrangement, reshaping and resizing of grains. So how we will know that this is the recrystallization temperature? So recrystallization temperature is usually 0.3 to 0.5 times of the melting temperature. So you have melting temperature, you can multiply it with 0.5 or 0.3, that melting temperature is reduced. Now this temperature is that temperature which is the recrystallization temperature, in which the atoms are in which atoms are rearrangement or reshaping sizing of grains take place. So warm work is performed at a temperature above room temperature but below recrystallization temperature. So if you have recrystallization temperature and you are going to perform warm working, so definitely you have to wait so that temperature comes below the recrystallization temperature. So that is dividing line between the cold working and warm working, often expressed in term of melting point. Here it is also given 0.3 TM. So T, melting point, absolute temperature for metal. Lower strength and high in strain hardening while higher ductility. So आपको मैंने बताया है कि जब temperature high हो तो आपकी strength low होती है और strain hardening भी low होती है while your ductility is high. Advantages of warm working. So definitely due to high temperature above the room temperature, lower forces are and powers is required to deform the material than in cold working operation. More intricate work geometry possible. So due to high temperature, more complex shapes can be obtained by using warm working. need for annealing may be reduced or eliminated. So if you are going to perform warm working, so there is no need for annealing, and or there is you can say that the annealing need may be reduced. Now, what is hot working? So deformation at temperature above recrystallization temperature. So that hot working is performed somewhat above the recrystallization temperature. So आपको बता दिया, आप definitely clear हो गया होगा कि cold temperature जो है, cold working जो है वो at room temperature or slightly above. Hot work, warm working जो है वो somewhat below the recrystallization temperature, while hot working is performed at a temperature above recrystallization temperature. So recrystallization temperature is equal to about one half of the melting point of absolutely scale, or 0.5 or 0.3. The range was given as 0.3 to 0.35. Well, 0.3 is the minimum and 0.5 is the maximum. So you can take the recrystallization temperature as maximum 0.5 TM. Metal continues to soften as temperature increases above 0.5 TM, enhancing advantage of hot working above this level. Now 0.75 is generally considered as the upper limit, as heat generated due to deformation can lead to the melting above the temperature. So recrystallization may take place during or after the deformation. So you can perform deforming operation above the recrystallization temperature. So definitely the atoms or the grains will rearrange in themselves after the deformation and will get a certain shape. Why hot working? So capability for substantial plastic deformation of metal far more than possible with cold working or warm working. आपको अगर कहा क्यों हम hot working करते हैं, तो क्योंकि हॉट वर्किंग की वजह से जो है वो टेम्परेचर हाई होता है, एंड इट विल बी इजी फॉर अस टू डिफॉर्म द मटेरियल और मेटल अकॉर्डिंग टू द डिजायर्ड शेप. सो स्ट्रेंथ कोफिशिएंट इज सब्सटेंशियली लेस देन एट रूम टेम्परेचर. स्टेट हार्डनिंग एक्सपोनेंट इज जीरो थ्योरेटिकली, एंड डक्टिलिटी इज सिग्निफिकेंटली इंक्रीज. सो दैट्स व्हाई मेटल कैन इजीली फ्लो एंड विल गेट द डिजायर्ड शेप अकॉर्डिंग बेस्ड ऑन द डाई. Now, what are the advantages? Work part shape can significantly altered. Maximum alteration can be done with the help of hot working. Lower forces and powers are required. That is already discussed. You can now able to understand these words. Metal that usually fracture in cold working can be hard form. अच्छा, जो metal जो है जिन पे आप working करते हैं cold working, और cold working की वजह से उसमें fracture आ जाते हैं, ठीक है, और fail हो जाते हैं, तो उनको आप हार्ड फॉर्म कर सकते हैं. तो हार्ड फॉर्मिंग का एक ये भी फायदा हुआ. स्ट्रेंथ प्रोपोर्शन ऑफ प्रोडक्ट आर जनरली आइसोट्रॉपिक, नो ग्रेन ओरिएंटेशंस, नो स्ट्रेंथनिंग ऑफ पार्ट्स अकर फ्रॉम वर्क हार्डनिंग. सो एडवांटेजेस इन द केस व्हेन पार्ट इज टू बी सब्सिक्वेंटली प्रोसेस बाय कोल्ड फॉर्मिंग. सो नो स्ट्रेंथनिंग ऑफ पार्ट्स अकर फ्रॉम वर्क हार्डनिंग. अगर आप हार्ड वर्किंग करें तो उसकी वजह से जो है वो पार्ट में कोई भी स्ट्रेंथनिंग नहीं आती. दैट इज द मेन एडवांटेज ऑफ हॉट वर्किंग. डिसएडवांटेज इज लोअर डायमेंशनल एक्यूरेसी. चूंकि जाहिर है वो मेटल जो है वो प्लास्टिकली ज़्यादा फ्लो करता है, डिफॉर्म होता है, इसीलिए जो है वो लोअर डायमेंशनल एक्यूरेसी. शायद हो सकता है वो प्रॉपरली फिल ना हो, या जो है वो प्रॉपरली जो है वो डिफॉर्म उस एरिया को कवर ना कर पाए डाइस की. तो दैट इज लोअर डायमेंशनल एक्यूरेसी. हायर टोटल एनर्जी रिक्वायर्ड ड्यू टू थर्मल एनर्जी दैट हीट. अच्छा, तो उसमें आपको हीट की रिक्वायर्ड होती है. आप उसको समवट अबाउट रिक्रिस्टलाइजेशन टेम्परेचर करते हो, सो यू मस्ट रिक्वायर्ड हीट एनर्जी. सो दैट इज आवर डिसएडवांटेज ऑफ हॉट वर्किंग. वर्क सर्फिस ऑक्सीडेशन स्केल, पुअर सर्फिस फिनिश. अच्छा, चूंकि हॉट सरफेस होती है मेटल की, सो दैट इज रेडी फॉर ऑक्सीडेशन, दैट इज रेडी फॉर रिएक्शन विद ऑक्सीजन. सो दैट विल आल्सो कॉज अ पुअर, उसमें ऑक्सीडेशन के चांसेस ज्यादा होते हैं. सो ये भी एक डिसएडवांटेजेस हैं जिसकी वजह से स्केल्स या जो ऑक्सीडेशन की वजह से जो रिएक्शन होता है, जो मटीरियल बनता है वो उसके ऊपर जम जाता है. दैट इज कॉल्ड स्केल. उसकी सरफेस पुअर फिनिश सरफेस होती है और shorter tool life, और इनके जो tools की जो है वो life जो है वो shorter होती है, because they are in contact with the hot metals. Strain rate sensitivity. Theoretically, a metal in hot working behaves like a perfectly plastic material with strain hardening exponent n is equal to zero. Agar ek metal hai and that is dealing with hot working, so it will definitely behave like a plastic material and it will have strain hardening component and will be equal to zero. So in that case, the metal should continue to flow at the same flow stress once the stress is reached. However, an additional phenomena occur during deformation, especially at elevated temperature, that is called strain rate sensitivity. So what is strain rate? Strain rate is in forming is directly related to speed deformation V. Now this strain rate is the rate at which the strain is going to produce, that is directly related with the speed of deformation. That is actually strain rate define you that how much deformation is going on. So deformation speed V is the velocity of frame or other movement of the equipment. So strain rate is defined as epsilon dot, that is V by H. Now V is the velocity of the RAM or movement of the equipment, or you can say the speed of deformation, and H is the instantaneous height workpiece deformed. So that how much the height of the workpiece is deformed. So that will tell you the strain rate. In most practical operation, valuation of strain is complicated by the work part geometry. Now, and the second is variation in strain rate is different region of the part. So in most of practical operation, the get the value of this strain rate, that is difficult. Because why? Because if you have a complex work part geometry, so how you will be able to determine the instantaneous height of the workpiece being deformed and the variation in the strain rate in different region of the parts. So that is the main reason that to get the value of this strain rate is often difficult in practical operation. So strain rate can reach 1000 per second or more for some metal forming operation. Effect of strain rate on flow stress. So what is the effect of strain rate or flow stress? Flow stress is a strong function of temperature. YF is generally a strong function of temperature. However, at hot working temperature, flow stress also depend on strain rate. So as strain rate increases, resistance to deformation increases. Jitna strain rate increase hota hai, theek hai na, to resistance to deformation increase hota hai. Kyunki strain rate ki jo definition hai, agar aap wo dekhe, to V over H, theek hai na, to V over H, it means ki speed of deformation to the height instantaneous being performed. Theek hai na, to iski ye value kab zyada hogi strain rate, jabki ye value kam hogi. To ye value kya, instantaneous height of work being deformed. So it ka iska matlab hai ki ye strain rate agar zyada hoga to deformation usme kam produce hogi. So that's why a strain rate increases, resistance to deformation increases. This effect is known as strain rate sensitivity. So as strain rate is increased, the resistance to deformation increases. This usually plot a straight line on log paper. Agar aap log paper pe strain rate sensitivity equation ko draw kare, so that will be a straight line. ठीक है ना, ये normally flow stress और strain rate के दरमियान curve है, लेकिन अगर इसे log curve पे draw करें, that will give you a straight line, and this m slope will define the angle, or you can say the strain rate आप कह सकते हैं, or this constant आप कह सकते हैं. ठीक है ना, so effect of strain rate on the flow stress at an elevated working temperature, same relationship plotted. Agar this is the actually the same, but this is plotted on a log curve coordinates, and it is divided drawn on the simple curve. Observation about strain rate sensitivity. Increasing temperature decreases C. ठीक है, अगर देखे अगर जितना टेम्परेचर इंक्रीज हो गया, सी ये कांस्टेंट है, सी इज द स्ट्रेंथ कांस्टेंट सिमिलरली बट नॉट इक्वल टू स्ट्रेंथ कोएफिशिएंट इन लो कर्व, एंड एम इज स्ट्रेन रेंज सेंसिटिविटी कंपोनेंट, ठीक है। अच्छा अब ये कह रहा है कि इंक्रीजिंग टेम्परेचर डिक्रीजेस सी इंक्रीजेस एम, ठीक है। तो ये जो इक्वेशन है इसमें अगर हम टेम्परेचर को इंक्रीज करते हैं तो सी की वैल्यू डिक्रीज होती है और स्ट्रेन रेंज सेंसिटिविटी एक्सपोनेंट जो है वो इंक्रीज होता है। सो ए ट्रू टेम्परेचर इफेक्ट ऑफ स्ट्रेन रेट इज ऑलमोस्ट नेग्लिजिबल बट फ्लो कर्व इज गुड रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ मटेरियल बिहेवियर बट एट हाई टेम्परेचर द स्ट्रेन रेट बिकम इंक्रीजिंगली इम्पॉर्टेंट इन डिफॉर्मिंग फ्लो स्ट्रेस। आपको कहा गया है कि देखें टेम्परेचर इंक्रीज करने से एम की वैल्यू बढ़ती है, एम क्या स्ट्रेन रेट सेंसिटिविटी एक्सपोनेंट है, ठीक है ना। सो एज टेम्परेचर इंक्रीजेस द स्ट्रेन रेट बिकम इंक्रीजिंगली इम्पॉर्टेंट इन डिटरमाइनिंग द फ्लो स्ट्रेस, ठीक है। सो दैट्स व्हाई अ मोर कॉम्प्लिकेट एक्सप्रेशन फॉर फ्लो स्ट्रेस एज अ फंक्शन ऑफ बोथ स्ट्रेन एंड स्ट्रेन रेट वुड बी द फॉलोइंग। सो ए वाई एफ इज इक्वल टू ए एप्सिलॉन एन इनटू एप्सिलॉन डॉट एम। सो एप्सिलॉन डॉट इज स्ट्रेन रेट rate sensitivity or you can say that that is strain rate. So for better to explain, so this is the final equation that will describe you both strain and strain rate. So yf is equal to a epsilon n into epsilon dot n. So this is a flow curve stress strain curves at a different temperature, that is room temperature, that is 400 800 and 1200. So you can see that at higher temperature, the strain rate is increased as compared to the lower temperature. That is cold working, hot working, and warm working and hot working. There are temperature ranges in cold working below the at room temperature or slightly above room temperature. In hot working, the temperature range will be that. While in warm working and hot working, the temperature is red, and the value of strain rate sensitivity exponent is also given in coefficient of flexion. Also, now flexion in metal forming arises because of the close contact between tools and work surface and the high pressure that drive the surface together in these operations. So there definitely when there is a die and metal and they will come in contact, so there will be a friction between these surfaces. So in most metal forming process, friction is undesirable, that is not required, because we are going to change the shape of metal due to metal forming. So in that case, friction will be undesirable. Metal is flow is retarded, because due to this friction, the flow of metal is stopped or they are retarded. Forces and powers are increased, definitely wear tooling faster, and they due to this friction the tools also wears fastly. Friction and tool wears are most wear in hot working. In case of hot working, this frictions and tool wear is severe. Friction in metal forming is more severe than machine parts, where there is low contact pressure, low to moderate temperature, and ample lubrication to avoid metal to metal contacts. So in that case, we need lubrication to avoid these frictions. Metal working lubricants are applied to tool work interface in many forming operation to reduce the harmful effect of friction. So lubrication is performed in order to reduce the harmful effect of friction. So the benefit will reduce sticking forces, power, tool wears, better surface finish will be yielded, and it removes heat from the tooling as well. So lubricant used for cold working operation includes mineral oil, fats and fatty oil, water-based emulsion, soaps, and anything. While in hot working, some type performed dry, the used lubricant includes mineral oil, graphites, and glasses. Consideration in choosing an appropriate metal working lubricant. So while choosing the metal working lubricants, you must be considered these points. So what are these points? So these points are type of forming operation, rolling, forging, sheet metal, hot working or cold working, work material, chemical reactivity with the tooling and work materials, ease of application, toxicity, flammability, and cost. So all these factors must be included while you are going to choose a metal working lubricants. This is homework 3 and 4. So leave it. We will. I will give you a separate homework. Cause due to pandemic, you cannot visit a local industries. So definitely, I will give you a certain home task that you will perform later. So for time being, just leave it. So that was end of the lecture regarding fundamental of metal forming process. So if you go to this chapter number, let's see, that is chapter number, I think 18. So I am going to over, you kindly go through this chapter. These are 4 or 6 pages you just go through. So metal forming operation is actually the type of operation in which metals are going to deform plastically. So they are divided into 2, bulk deformation and sheet metal. In bulk deformation process, surface area to volume is low, while in sheet metal process, surface area to volume ratio is high. And so both these processes are used to alter the shape of the material due to plastic deformation of the material under high excessive forces. They have their separate types: rolling, forming, extrusion, drying, sheet metal working, bending, deep drawing, shearing, miscellaneous process. In next lecture, inshallah, we will explain these different rolling, forging, extrusion, and wire and bar process, as well as sheet metal process. So this was all about today's lecture. I hope you have learned many things by this lecture. Inshallah, we will continue our next lecture that will be about that will be about bulk deformation process, and then we will discuss sheet metal process. So I think we will cover up to till midterm, we will cover up till sheet metal process. So we have 2 chapter left: bulk deformation and sheet metal. That will be covered in this coming week, or that coming week is 3rd week, I hope so. So by this, I'm going to turn off the recording. If you have any question, you can ask me, or we can arrange a session for that. Thank you so much. Love you.